All right, welcome back to episode 3 of our Elite Squad podcast. Today we got Derek Cartaya with us, second baseman for FIU, Elite Squad lifer. I think, Derek, you played for us when you were how old? Like 14 you started with us?
14.
Yeah, and then I coached you on a different team when you were 13, right, with David Flores and yep. All them. So, you know, out of West Pine. So I've known Derek since he was a little kid at 13 years old, and now obviously he played for us, and he's at FIU. So say hi to everybody, Derek.
Hello, everybody.
And obviously I have Callie with us again. So Callie, say what's up.
What's going on, everybody?
All right. So, you know, before we get into the actual interview and you know, talking about what we got going on today and our subject for today, I like to tell a little quick little story. And one of my fondest memories of Derek and whoever we have on the show that week, my favorite memory, and there's a lot of memories with Derek, because Derek, those of you that don't know, okay, you know, I know I say this a lot about, you know, I say this so far, I've said it with Willie, I've said it with Zach, but I really do mean it. And I have a lot of favorite players. You know, a lot of these kids that I've coached have become, you know, part of my family. And Derek's one of those kids where, yeah, he's another one that's one of my favorite players. And I think most coaches that have coached him, you know, Coach O'Neill Garcia, who coached him at Somerset, can vouch for this. You know, when Derek plays for you, he's one of those kids that leaves an impression on you just because of the way he plays. And he's another coach out there, another coach on the field. And he, one of the smartest players I've coached. You know, I've always said this, like Luis Guillorme was probably the smartest infielder that I've coached, and Derek's in that category. So that's a compliment to you, because Mike, you played with Luis, you know, in high school, and Luis is a special ball player. You know, there's not many Luis Guillormes out there. You saw, as everybody's seen this spring training, you know, the things that he can do physically. But, you know, I always said that Luis was like my quarterback in the infield. I never really had to call a bunch of fake plays, or, you know, and even with Derek, same thing, you know, where Luis would go out there and kind of align people and stuff like that. Derek was the same way, and he still is that way, because I've talked to his college coach, and he's still the same guy where he's talking to his teammates, lining them up. And Derek used to come to me like, Coach, you know, we used to always tell me things about the other team and what they were doing. So Derek, by far, is one of the smartest players that I've had, one of my favorites that I've coached, just because of the energy that he brings. And, you know, listen, he's 5'7", Derek?
No chance.
I'll tell you, Derek.
5'4" on a good day.
Yes, all right. So he's 5'4", and he plays like the biggest guy on the field. And you know, I know like Mr. Rooks used to, you know, call him big man, and you know, we all mess with him. But, you know, what sets him apart is his energy and the way he plays the game, and obviously his leadership qualities. But going back to one of my favorite memories about Derek Cartaya, and he'll remember this because this is what got him recruited. We were in the Final Four of the – was it 2014? We won the BCS in 2014, Derek? Do you remember what year it was?
16-year summer.
Yeah, so you were – yeah. Yeah, so 2014, we're in the Final Four of the Perfect Game BCS in Fort Myers. We're throwing Greg Velez the next day, okay? Those of you that don't know Greg Velez, he's pitching at University of Miami. Still is a very, very good pitcher. Throws at that time, I mean, he was every bit of 93, 95 miles an hour as a 16-year-old. So these kids, and I love that group to death, and you know, his group was awesome. A lot of good freshmen in college right now, a lot of kids that got drafted last year. We're on that team. But I tell these kids, you know, who were starting, and I didn't even think to say, hey, don't tell anybody, you know, but when you're starting a 95 mile an hour pitcher, teams are going to want to, you know, I guess know about it. And they had – the team that we were playing is actually the team that his college head coach, Merville Melendez, his son played for. So we're playing them the next day. And it just so happens that our guys are friends with each other, like always. And our guys were friends with a bunch of teams. So, you know, we saw the matchup that it was going to be us versus NBA. And they start talking, and a couple of them are at the same hotel, whatever. Like, hey, who are you guys throwing tomorrow? And obviously, their kids are 16-year-olds. They don't even think about it. They're like, hey, we're throwing Velez at you, you know? So what do these guys do? This other team goes at night. NBA goes at night to the batting cages. They run a cage, and they have this machine geared up at 100 miles an hour getting ready to face Velez. So, I didn't know this until I got to the field. And then Derek or somebody walks back, and they're kind of, like, laughing. And I'm like, well, what's going on? They're like, their coach is literally like 20 feet away from them, just chucking balls at them during BP. I'm like, why would he be doing that? And they're like, oh, because we told him that Velez was throwing. I'm like, why would you guys do that? Like, what's the point of that? God, you guys don't know how to keep your damn mouth shut, you know, whatever. So I didn't get too mad, but I was just like, you guys are idiots, man. Like, why would you guys tell them who we're throwing? So sure enough, the first inning, all they were doing was looking for first pitch fastballs and just trying to
come out swinging.
Yeah. I mean, like, they just cheated. They did. If we would have thrown a changeup, somebody might have hurt their back because they were just guessing it, and they would have swung right through the pitch. But they just came out hacking, you know, and credit to Greg. He settled down after that and eventually got us a win. But that being said, you know, we go, I think we're down two runs, you know, at the time.
First inning.
Was it the first inning?
Yep.
Okay. So we're down two runs in the first inning, but I don't know if this happened. What inning did your double happen?
First inning.
Was it the first inning?
I was hitting second, and yeah, okay. I think Eric was leading off.
Yeah, Eric Rivera, who's starting for FAU this year as a freshman, Eric leads off, I think, with a single or a walk, whatever. He gets on base. So Derek goes the very next batter. Derek's the second batter of the game. He hits a ball into the gap and crushes it. He crushes this pitch. I mean, it's probably one of the first balls he's hit. I don't know in his life, but at least that summer. He absolutely crushes this ball. Before he takes two steps out of the box, he turns to our dugout and says, "Let's go!" And then he starts sprinting down the line and turns it into a double. I mean, obviously, every one of our guys got fired up. But the best part about that is after that game, you know, Coach Melendez comes up to me and says, "I love that kid. I love the way he plays." And it wasn't just because of that, but like that made him look like, who the hell is this kid? You know, second batter of the game smacks a double and screaming at his team as he's running down the line. And we were in the third base dugout. So it wasn't like he just said it, you know, as he's running by first base. No, he turned around as soon as he hit it. He hit the ball and he turned around and yelled at our dugout to let's go. And it's a 9 a.m. game. So that woke us up right there. And, you know, that eventually got him, you know, the scholarship that, you know, to go play for Coach Melendez. And not just that instance, but that right there, you know, is kind of like, kind of sums up who Derek Cartaya was and is currently, but at least for us, he was that leader. I mean, yeah, he's 5'4 on a good day, whatever, but he's that leader for you, you know. And God, I had so many, you know, so many good stories and so many good memories coaching him and so much fun coaching him because he does keep the game fun for you. You know, he's not somebody that's ever too hard on himself and too serious. I mean, it was tough for me to really get mad at him at times because I would yell at him and then he'd just smile afterwards. And I'm like, get out of here. Get out of my face. you know, so it was tough. And there was times where I got pissed at him like anybody. You know, I get pissed at everybody for certain things, but nothing too serious, obviously. But, you know, it would be tough for me to stay mad at him too long. You know, and we were talking about it before we came on where, you know, we're in Fort Myers again in the fall. And you know, I think it was bases loaded or a runner on second and third. And it's a 3-0 count. And I never do this with you know, I only give 3-0 green lights to certain guys, usually not a leadoff guy like Derek was for us. But I said, you know what? I was tough on Derek earlier in the tournament. I'm going to give him the green light here. And sure enough, give him the green light. He pops up to the pitcher. I just remember cursing him all the way back to the dugout. Like, that's why I don't get – because I think he asked me. Like, there was a conference. Yeah, that's what it was. There was a conference out in the mound. Like, the pitcher goes – he goes 3-0, and for whatever reason, the coach at that point decided to go to the mound. So he comes up to me, you know, Derek comes up to me, he goes, "Coach, give me the green light." I said, "Derek, if I give you the green light, you better crush this pitch. I don't care if you get out, just crush it." He goes, "Coach, I got you. I got you." Sure enough, right, pops it up in the middle of the infield, and I'm just like, oh my God. But no, there was a lot of positive memories. Like, I can't tell you how much, you know, Derek did for us in terms of just, like I said, just the passion that he brought and every single one of his teammates absolutely loved him for that. You know, he made huge plays for us the following year. I think he scored the go-ahead run against the Triton Rays in the playoffs off of bad bunt. You know, he was at first base. I'm sorry, off a bad throw. You know, Joe Skinner lays down a bunt for us and he runs to second base. And the guy tries to backpick him, and for whatever reason, the guy wasn't there. Ball sails into left field. He comes around and scores. And, you know, I mean, there's so many plays that he made for us. But, and I could talk forever about the contributions that he made and how fun it was coaching somebody like that and somebody that plays the way that he does. But I know that, you know, we're trying to keep this thing under an hour, hour and a half. So I won't go too much further. I know, Callie, there's some things that you want us to talk about. And Derek, I'll get into some of the questions that I know that our fans or our players would want to know from you. So talk to me, Callie, what you got for us today?
Yeah, so I think this is, you know, you and I were talking last night, Richie, you know, during the World Baseball Classic. I don't think we've seen this much passion in the game of baseball in a long time, really. And it's great that we have Derek on this week, because all you've ever talked about Derek is this kid plays with passion. This is the baseball player that he is, you know. So I want to know from you guys, the way, you know, last night, Nelson Cruz hits the home run. The entire Dominican Republic nation is on the field right. partying, you know. Today, Jose Bautista makes the throw home. They tag him out at the plate. The entire Colombian team is on the field wanting to fight the umpire, you know. I want to know from you guys, is it too much? Is it crossing the line? Or is it exactly what our game needs?
Let's go ahead first. With. Oh, hey,
let's go to Derek first. Derek,
all right, Derek, you go.
I obviously, coming from me, I'm gonna love it. That's how I've always played the game. But I guess it's kind of a cultural thing. Mm-hmm. You know, us Hispanics, I guess. You know, usually we play a game with a little more fire, a little more flair. We like to show off a little more. We care more about, you know, a lot of times how we look rather than just getting the job done.
But look good, play good, though, man. Look good, play good.
Yeah, look good, play good. But I don't know. It goes either way, because let's say you're a pitcher and you get a bomb hit off you in a big situation in a game. The guy pimps it, whatever. You get mad. But now what happens if you strike him out in a big situation? You know, It goes both ways. If you're going to be fiery, be fiery. Like, I don't see any problem with it. I enjoy watching it.
Yeah, I'm Derek, I'm with you on that. I love it, man. I love it. I'm gonna be honest with you, and I know this might come as a surprise, because baseball's what I do. That's all I do. That's what I've done for the past 10 years, whatever it is. But you know, I don't watch much Major League Baseball, surprisingly. I'll follow the Marlins because they're our local team, but you won't catch me sitting there on a Wednesday night, because ESPN usually has the Cardinals on. Okay, they love to show the Cardinals, but you won't watch me just sitting down on a Wednesday night watching a game. I mean, I have better things to do. And not because of anything other than the fact that, you know, I feel a lot of Major League Baseball has gotten boring, you know. And I will watch, however, that being said, I'll watch college baseball all day long, you know. Probably why I don't watch much Major League Baseball on Wednesdays is because I'm usually in front of my computer on ESPN3 watching college baseball. You know, I'll watch random teams. Like, even if we don't have an elite squad guy on that team and it's a good matchup, I'll watch those two teams play, you know, because of the excitement. And that's exactly what it is. That game, the emotion of it is what's awesome about it. You know, the World Baseball Classic, I wish they would do it once a year. You know, I would, and I could go a whole year without watching a Major League Baseball game and just watch that. You know what I mean? Because I think it's awesome. I really do think it's awesome. And they're talking about, you know, we talked with Willie about the bat flips and all that stuff. And, you know, look, I would have a problem if the Dominicans or the Colombians came out and they were pointing their fingers at the pitcher. You know what I mean? But they're not. They're celebrating their own team.
With their own team, exactly.
Yeah, listen, this is a kid's game. You know, like, we're playing a kid's game. We grew, you know, 95% of us started this when we were probably under the age of 10 or 11, whatever it is. So, you know, this is a kid's game. And for those guys to show that raw emotion and, I think it's awesome. At the same time, I was pissed because I'm rooting for USA, you know. And, I mean, but I'm bitter at USA for, you know, because the best players aren't playing there, you know. And this could be a subject for another day. But, you know, you look at this USA team, and they're good, don't get me wrong. But where's Trout? Where's Harper? You know, where's Syndergaard? Where's DeGrom? You know, like, so you can get mad all you want, but the best Dominicans are playing. The best Puerto Ricans are playing. And guess what? They're having a blast doing it. That's, you know, exactly, so exactly. And that's it, you know, and that's what I love about it. You know, and you know, I know the baseball purists don't like all that stuff, but what is more pure than playing the game for the country and with people that you love? you know? So baseball purists don't like all this excitement and jumping around and stuff. But guess what, man? Like, these guys are just playing for the love of the game. Whereas we got guys in USA that are, I don't want to say they're too good, but, you know, obviously their contract's more important to them than playing in this. So, you know, that's my opinion. I absolutely 100% love the passion of the World Baseball Classic. And listen, from all the teams, not just the Puerto Ricans and the Dominicans, you know, I mean, from all the teams, look at Israel, what they're doing. Those guys are fired up over there, you know, and half of those people weren't born in Israel. Obviously they come from Jewish descent, but they're playing for a reason. You know, they're playing for a bigger purpose than just a win. And I don't, you know, I know this is another subject, but I don't know I don't know why more players, American-born players, don't feel that way. I guess it's just something I don't understand. You know, why we don't have a Harper and a Trout and you know, other guys. And I understand it's contrastive, but God damn, like, we live in the best country in the world, man. Go represent us. I don't know. I'm just talking as a fan, you know, but I know I went off on a tangent, but I would love it, man. And I'll tell you this. I'll give credit to the guys that are currently playing on USA. They got down to Colombia 2-0. I was at that game. When they tied that game, they were going nuts. So the current players that, you know, that are on USA's roster, I think it's awesome. And those guys care about winning. You know, they may not show as much emotion on the field, but when they scored that winning run, or I'm sorry, when they scored the tying run, and the tying run was Arenado, I believe, struck out. Check this play out. You know, Arenado struck out. Ball gets through the catcher's legs. He's running to first. He dives to be safe, you know, which we all say don't do it. But he ends up lodging the ball out of the guy's glove because his leg, he dives head first. The back leg gets in the way of the glove. Safe. That run scores with two outs. This is all with two outs. And their dugout was going nuts. I don't know if they showed it on TV or not because I was at the game. But, like, that is awesome, man. Arenado, you know, that is awesome.
Arenado, when he went in head first and they called him safe, he gets up. He's like, whoa, you know, yeah. Like, let's go. You know, it's
– like, how can you be – you know, yeah, exactly. And, like, me as a fan, like, we were fired up. It was me, my brother, and my dad. We were fired up. If you're Trout, Harper, anybody, you know, that's an American-born player watching that, like – that, if that doesn't get you fired up, man, like, God, I haven't played the game myself in I don't know how many years. Over 10 years, okay, since I played a competitive baseball game. I wanted to go down there and be in that dugout and be part of it. Like, I wanted to play after I saw that. So, you know, I just don't, you know, I don't get it why these guys aren't playing. I know it has to do with finances and, you know, contracts and all that stuff. But the World Baseball Classic, the passion that these guys are showing, the passion that college players show, our game means more of it. You know, and I think the only way that we'll see that is that if there's no repercussions for it. You understand what I'm saying? Like, in the World Baseball Classic, it's accepted because you know that you're dealing with people from different cultures. But in Major League, you do that, now you got to worry about guys getting beamed because, you know, Johnny, whatever, didn't like it on the mound. Like, that's, you know, excuse my language, that's bullshit. You know what I mean? Like, they didn't do anything wrong. They're celebrating their teammate hit a home run. You can't be sensitive, man. Like, you're going to be sensitive because they're happy their teammate hit a home run off you, you know? And I think that's why you don't see it in baseball. So baseball has, if they want to see more excitement, they're going to have like harsh repercussions for people that throw at other people. Does that make sense?
I think it's, that's why, you know, you talked about Major League Baseball and college baseball. And let's use an example from, you know, Derek. He, you know, they got a guy on second. Deep fly ball hit the center field, gets over the center fielder's head. He's tagging from second, coming all the way around. They walk off against the University of Miami, which is huge, huge for an FIU squad that hasn't played them in years. The passion, like, it was a mob scene in that at that place. Right. Derek, what was it like, you know, coming out of that dugout, you know, just the feeling? I'm sure you guys didn't go to sleep for a long time that night. You know?
It was great. Off the bat, Nick Day hit the ball. He's probably one of the strongest kids I've ever met in my life. He hits balls in BP. We have like a 100-foot net behind our left field wall, and he hits him out with one hand out in front, just ugly, just hits him out. Just country power. So off the bat, we thought, wow, he just hit it over dead center to walk it off. Whatever, tracks it down. The kid that pinch ran on second base, the last time he ran a 60 was a 6-1-3.
Jeez.
And he just flies. So he takes off to third, and knowing Merv, there's no chance he's holding him at third base. There's no chance. Everybody in the dugout knows, but nobody in the stands knows. If you saw the video, like, everyone just starts cheering. Like, you hear, oh, he catches it, everybody goes silent. They start cheering when he goes to third, and it goes silent. And all of a sudden, you hear everybody go, he's running, he's running, he's running. And we all knew in the dugout, there's no way he's holding him. So he slides headfirst into home. And, man, if it wasn't even half a second. Our whole dugout was already outside by the time he had slid into home. We were already, like, by the foul line.
That was awesome. And that's exactly why.
Yeah.
And look, and don't get me wrong, MLB, you know, the players in Major League Baseball, they celebrate walk-offs. You know, they do. They do their, you know, their water and all that stuff. But, you know, like, reasons like that, not the way that these guys do. You know, not the way that college players do.
Yeah, no.
And even before that, like, you know, or even during those games, you know, you're watching a college game on ESPN3 or whatever you're streaming it with, like, you see the raw emotion of these kids, good and bad, you know, but after they get out of a big inning, or if they get a big hit, you know, or if they do it, there's so much in, I guess, yeah, passion, but there's so much enjoyment for playing the game,
mm-hmm.
you know? And I think that's what's missing because, you know, let's face it, these guys, you know, in Major League, they're older, they're playing for contracts. They look at this as a business. They look at themselves as a business, you know? However, I think that we got to find, you know, that fine line, man, where, you know, yeah, this is a business. You're making a lot of money, man, but shit, go out and have some fun. Mm-hmm. Have some fun while you're doing it, you know? You know, I don't know what the answer is to that. I don't know how to do it. I can tell you this. If MLB, I think one of the answers in the direction they should go in is if you're caught throwing at a guy on purpose, there should be severe suspension. You don't, not just missing one start. Let's talk about five. You know what I mean? Like, then people will think twice about beating somebody just because I don't like the way he looked at that home run. You know what I mean?
It's a complete safety issue.
Right, no doubt. I mean, you want to protect your product. There's no reason why Jose Bautista should be getting drilled in the back. I mean, he's one of the best players in baseball. So if you really want to protect your product, and, you know, listen, you could talk crap about the NFL, but they've taken measures to protect their quarterbacks. You know what I mean? So, I mean, this year was the first time that their viewership was down in I don't know how many years, but I think that has more to do with the Kaepernick situation and other stuff. But you can't tell me that football hasn't been the biggest, you know, I guess – sport in our country for the past, I don't know, 10, 15 years, you know? So, and they've taken steps to make sure that their game and their, I guess, their best players are protected, you know? So that's my thought on that. But, yeah, passion, definitely. Want more of it, man. Love it.
Man.
That's why I like Derek so much. That's why I love coaching him so much, man, because he's one of those guys, you know? I already talked about, you know, his leadership skills and what he does on the baseball field, but the way he plays the game. And, you know, the reason why he got a scholarship, why a kid that's 5'4" got a scholarship to a good Division I university is because of his passion and the way he plays the game. Yes, he's a good ball player, but Derek, you would attest to this. There's a lot of good ball players on your team, and we played against a lot of good ball players. So there's things that Derek has to do at 5'4" that's got to separate himself, you know? It's not fabricated. That's the best part about it. Like, that's who he is. Because, you know, there's guys that do that fake hustle.
The rah-rah.
Yeah, that, you know, they're fake and you know, it, all that stuff. But that's Derek 24-7. You know, whether Derek's hitting 400 or he's hitting a .150, he ain't going to change. You know, that's just him. So, that's good, man. I like your answer to the passion part, Derek. I think you're spot on. And, you know, I think we all agree. I think we're all in agreement with that. So I'm going to get into a couple questions now, Derek. You know, we're having a little fun with this. I know that a bunch of our, you know, former players would want to know, or a bunch of our players would want to know. So I'm going to go in. We're going to talk a little bit first about your college experience so far, okay? So tell people, originally, when you committed, Coach Melendez was at Alabama State, okay? Mm-hmm. So you got committed to Alabama State when that happened. Obviously, he gets the job at FIU. What's going on through your head? Obviously, you're at FIU. You chose to follow him to FIU. What's going on through your head when you first hear, okay, Coach Melendez is now at FIU? I know you texted me, but I want you to tell people, you know. You texted me right away when that happened. You're like, Coach, did you hear what happened? I was like, yeah, just relax. I go, we'll figure this thing out. But talk to us. Tell us.
I said, well, this could be really good or this could be really bad. You know, I was going to Alabama State because of Merv. Merv was the one who recruited me. So I was going there. I wanted to play for him.
Right.
When I found out, you know, there had been rumors going around, whatever. I wake up one morning and on my Twitter handle, I see Ravel Melendez to speak with press today at FIU. So whatever, I'm waiting all day and I finally see that he's taking the head coaching job. At the time, I think he was in Mexico, or he was somewhere with the USA team coaching. He was somewhere. So, you know, his phone really didn't work. It really had no communication there. I was freaking out. But I was thinking, you know, either I could, you know, stay home and go to a local JUCO maybe for a year and then find somewhere else to play, or hopefully he can take me with him. And if he could take me with him, that'd be awesome. I get to stay close to home. I still have my family, my friends.
Sure.
You know, all that stuff. So it was a rough little ride there.
So what happened? So you finally got a hold of Merv, right? He called you after a few days when he got back.
Yep. And I told him, I said, listen,
he said, take me with you, coach.
Yeah. I said, I want to play for you, you know, like it's either there. Or I'm just going to try to go to JUCO somewhere. I don't want to go over there. He goes, well, you do whatever you got to do. So I ended up getting my release over there. And then I followed him over and I'm currently there now.
Yeah. Well, good, man. Good. I'm obviously, you know, I know that a big reason why a lot of people went to Alabama State was to play for Coach Melendez. You know, not saying that's everybody's case, but it's a big reason why a lot of the people in your class, you know, your freshmen were going to Alabama State or at FIU now. Not the case for everybody, but a large majority. Nick McDonald, one of our former players, also one of your teammates now. Did the same thing that you did. So I'm glad it worked out. I remember you texting me the morning of, and you know, I don't want to say you're freaking out, but you're freaking out. I was like, look, man, everything's gonna be okay. I'll get a hold of Merv. I'll find out what's going on. And you know, obviously everything worked out. And you're right, he was in Mexico, so I couldn't get a hold of him either to find out what was going on. So it all worked out. Going into the season, did you think that if I told you that you were going to start, or let me rephrase this. Going into the season, did you think that you'd be playing in 13 of the first 16 games of your freshman career and starting 11 of them? Did you think that that was a reality? Like, what were your thoughts going into this year? And let's not just say, tell me, I guess, when you come back to campus and you're practicing the first day of practice in the spring, what were your thoughts going into the season?
I knew coming back we were going to play a lot of inter squads. And in the fall, I did okay. Not too good, not too bad. I was getting on base a lot. You know, pretty much that's really all I had to do. You know, just get on base, make things happen. I was getting on base a lot. And I was told to that I could possibly, you know, play in the outfield or infield, wherever they needed me. So going into the break, I actually, my coaches don't know this, but I actually would practice in the infield and the outfield, like on my own. I'd take fly balls and stuff, and I played left field actually with you guys my 17 year summer a little bit.
Yep.
But I really didn't think, maybe not this early in the season, I'd be playing or starting actually.
Right.
No, I thought maybe once I got my opportunity, I could run off with it. But I definitely never thought this early in the season I'd be playing as much as I am right now.
Right, and that's a testament to you. And we talked a little bit off air, you know. And you know, you started 11 out of 16 games as a freshman. That's pretty damn good so far. You know, like you're in a pretty good situation. You know, we're gonna have our good weeks. We're gonna have our bad weeks. You know, your freshman year, you know, we talk about it all the time in Elite Squad. Like, hey, look, your freshman year of college might be the toughest and worst year of your life, you know, because there's so many new things that are going on besides baseball. Like, baseball's a small part of your life when you're a freshman. There's so many other things going on for you guys. A lot of you guys are off on your own for the first time, you know. So your freshman year, and anybody that's gone away from college can attest to this, it's tough. You know, it's very tough. So for you to start 11 of the 16 games so far in the season, that's pretty impressive. And you know, like I told you, you know, you're going to have your great weekends. You're going to have your bad ones. Some of them might pile up together, both good and bad. But what separates you, and I could talk to you as your coach, you know, what separated you for me always was, you know, the things that you did that don't show up on a box score. You know what I mean? The emotion that you would bring to a team, the confidence that you would bring to the team, like little things like this kid would go and, you know, again, he's 5'4", but the confidence that he's got, it's like he's 6'4". You know, he'd tell our kids, I'd see him, I'd be coaching third base, he'd be on deck, and he'd go back and tell our guys, like, hey, I'm going to light this guy up right now, and then we're going to get going. And sure enough, he'd go out and do it. You know what I mean? And we're talking about, you know, and that just got everybody going, and you know, he did that several times, you know. I will tell one funny story before I get into more questions. That same day that you got recruited, okay, in that same game where you hit that double and we're screaming, let's go, whatever, it was an intense game. Like, it was a back-and-forth affair. This is one of the funniest Elite Squad stories that I have. Okay, so we start, you know, they start chirping a little bit, and it's a really close game, back and forth. They score some runs, we score some runs, we retake the lead. They bring in this kid, okay, and I correct me if I'm wrong, Derek. So they bring this kid, we're yapping or whatever. He throws, I think they bring in this pitcher. He's throwing hard as hell. He overthrows a ball or whatever. And Derek, you know, says something. And it was one of those things where, like, everybody was kind of, like, talking or whatever. And it's one of those situations where the room gets quiet and you only hear your voice. So Derek said something to him, and he looks over, and I look over at Derek, and Derek's on deck or in the hole, whatever it was. I see Derek turn around, and he goes, like, the guy looks at him, he goes, oh, shit. He goes, everybody, give me your evil shield. He's going to drill me. He's putting on evil shield all over his arm. I remember, and he was wild. So, you know, there was one pitch where it got close, and the umpires actually stopped the game, and they're like, and I told him, I said, look, these are kids, it's a heated game. I told the umpires, said, you guys gotta take control, or something bad's gonna happen, because they drill one of our guys. I could tell my guys not to drill that their team, but I know what my guys are gonna do. Yeah, like my guys, yeah, okay, coach, I got you. And then they're gonna drill them. So the umpires took control, and then Derek is on his way up there, and Derek's like, coach, I'm gonna die. He goes, this guy's gonna hit me. I said, you'll be fine. They gave him warnings. Derek, go get it. I'm like, go get it. But that, do you remember that?
I do.
That was awesome. I the image of you, like, running back from the on-deck circle, give me your evil shields. Like, from the third base box, like, I was even smirking, like, this kid, man.
He's looking like a first base coach after a full-on batting around inning.
It was such a funny situation, because it was like, you know, you ever been in a room or where someone's loud and all of a sudden the music turns down and you're still talking loud? That's exactly what happened. And the kid just stared at Derek, and he's like, guys, give me your evil shield. It was hilarious, man. That was one of the best memories, like, one of the funniest moments that happened to me on the field. So, all right, getting back into the questions, though. I didn't mean to get too sidetracked, but things come to me as we get talking. So far, what's the best thing about college so far, in your opinion? Is that hard, huh? Okay, we'll do this. What's the worst part about college so far?
Class.
Okay.
The obvious answer.
No, I'd say probably just balancing out your schedule with school and baseball and weights and trying to get extra work in on your own.
Time management.
You know, pretty much, yeah, everything just piles up on you.
Yeah, and again.
I get school work done early.
No doubt, man, and I say this again, and we talked about it earlier, your freshman year is going to be the toughest year you'll have, because by this time next year, you're going to have it figured out. You know what I mean? You're like, all right, I've done this. I know what shortcuts I can take. I know which ones I can't. I know what I can do. You know, and you're just going to get better at managing your time, because like anything, you get through it. And right now, the half an hour that you have to yourself flies like this. You know, when you get good at it, you're going to see, like, by next year, you're going to get four or five things done in half an hour, you know, and you just adjust, you know, we adjust as people, and we've all been through it. That, like I said, that freshman year is tough, but you'll adapt, you know, and you aren't the only one that's gone through it. You know, everybody's kind of been in your situation and feels as overwhelmed as you guys do as freshmen. You know, Callie's been there. I've been there. Like, it's a lot. And I tell kids, we tell our kids all the time, like, hey man, the next level, like, it's a full-time job plus more. You know, to be an NCAA athlete, I don't think that a lot of our players realize it, no matter how much we tell you, right, Derek? Like, yeah, okay, absolutely. Coach, yeah, I know you're telling me. Exactly. Yeah. It's like, yeah, I know we're going to be busy, coach. I know it's hard, whatever. And then all of a sudden you get there, you're like, shit, Like, this was tough. Like, this is hard, you know? And we're like,
telling us that.
Yeah. And like, I told you so, you know? But like I said, it'll be easier. You know, every year that you're in school, it gets that much easier. Like it did in high school, man. You know, like it did in high school. And I'm not comparing the two as much as the workload, but, you know, you'll kind of know. And by the time you're a senior in high school, you know, you got to figure it out, man. You know? Yeah. So it'll all work out. So I'm going to go back to the question. What's the best thing about college?
Probably just like creating a brotherhood with a new group of people.
Yeah, I agree, man. The bonds that I made in college and in high school, don't get me wrong, I'm still, you know, best friends with one of my high school teammates. But the bonds that you create in college, man, they're pretty special because you're with them so damn much. You know what I mean?
Like, there's nothing like it.
Yeah, like,
you know, and if I'm not at practice with them, I have class with four or five of them.
Exactly. You know, and then chances are, because you got something else to do together, you're going to go eat with them. You know, yeah. Chances are you're going to go sleep over their house because they live closer to wherever we got to be in the morning, you know? So, yeah, I can tell you this, the relationships, and I learned this a long time ago, man, baseball's about the relationships you make along the way, you know? And those things, those relationships will last you a lifetime just because of how much you guys go through and you're going to go through for the next 3-4 years. So I agree with you on that. And that's a good answer. I'm surprised it took you that damn long to answer it though. all right, getting into some of the fun stuff. Before game, you listen to any pregame music?
No.
Yeah, you have enough energy. You don't need to listen to that.
Yeah, no.
Yeah. I don't know where he pulls it from, but he doesn't need to listen to music. So what do you do before game? Go on Twitter?
No. I just, you know, normal day. Nothing really special. I just get to the field earlier than usually a lot of people, and I'll just hit on my own before we do our pregame BP. Do my pregame batting practice, like routines, and then just get it going.
Yeah. Derek doesn't need any source of energy, you know? Like, he's. I'm surprised this guy even sleeps with as much energy as he's got. And he looks like, if people watching this for the first time might think Derek is the most relaxed, confident person, but he's the opposite. Like, not that he's not confident, but he's an energizer bunny. Like, this guy don't stop, you know. But right now, I guess in front of the camera, he's, you know, he's nice and relaxed. So it's good to see you in a different element, Derek, because I usually don't see that out of you.
Made for TV.
Yeah. All right, tell me your best Elite Squad memory that you have.
That one's easy.
All right, tell me.
17U summer.
Uh-huh.
East Cobb.
Uh-huh.
I think it's 0-0 in the bottom of the seventh inning against the Houston Bandidos.
Yes. Yes.
And Rylan Thomas goes over the scoreboard.
Yes.
Absolute no doubter.
Oh, my God. That's
– for a walk-off. And that took us to what, the Elite Eight? Yeah.
Yeah. That was the next game that you won. You scored the winning run the next game. And this is what I mean. And I don't want to sound like the biggest – I am. I'm one of the biggest Derek Cartaya fans. But this, Mike, this goes to prove you. I asked him what his best Elite Squad memory is. It has nothing to do with him. Yeah. You know what I mean? You know, and that's the type of kid that he is, and that's the type of teammate that he is, you know? And I don't want to sound like I'm, you know – yeah, I don't know. Whatever. I'm a big fan of his. So, but that's my point. Like, you see why coaches love this kid. You know, like, that's – this guy's been with us for – 4 years. He's had a lot of good memories himself. He's done a lot of good things for this program and for his teams. And his best memory is of one of his teammates hitting that bomb to help us win. You know what I mean? So that's awesome. That is, by the way, Ryan's been tearing it up. Have you been following?
Yeah, I heard.
Yeah, he's still hitting bombs, man. He's at UCF. He's a freshman at UCF and he's killing it. You know, he's killing it. I talked to Coach Clossy through text and they love him. And there's a lot to love about Rylan. And he had some, let me tell you something. That was an impressive tournament for Ryland, too.
Oh, man. He hit a walk-off the following game, too.
Yeah. Yeah. So, like, he was unconscious that tournament. All right. Well, you coached for us last summer, okay?
Yes, I did.
So, you coached for us last summer. Tell me something that you learned, something new that did you see anything different from the game of baseball? Then you didn't know. Did you see a different perspective, or you know, what do you think of your coaching experience? Because I bring this up because I hope you know, whenever your playing days are done, I'm calling and I'm like, hey, I got a job for you. You know, because you know, I think that Derek is going to make a great coach, and I know it's something that he's kind of expressed, you know, that he possibly would do when he's done playing. did you learn anything? Did you know, what was your thoughts about coaching? I know you coached our young guys. How'd you like it? You know, is it something that you want to do in the future?
I loved it.
Yeah. The kids loved you, man, which is a surprise. Awesome. Yeah.
They were awesome. But I don't know, I guess from the outside in, you see a lot more than what you do when you're actually in the game.
Yeah.
You realize a lot more.
Did you, did you ever get nervous coaching? Because I never got nervous when I played. Yeah, because you know what? You'll see. Yeah, I get nervous when, you know what, I'm trying to get you into college, and you've punched out twice, and now you're coming up for
a third time. I had a bunch of 14-year-olds at it.
Yeah. But you don't have to experience that. No, you're right. You're right. So go ahead. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, I mean, I liked it a lot, and pretty much just I liked the feeling of, like, the kids actually trusting me, you know, even though I was 18 years old going to be a freshman in college. Now, I'm coaching 14-year-olds, and I, you know, three-quarters of the team's taller than me, probably more than that, actually. You know, most of the kids had no idea who I was either, so just the fact that they trusted me.
They probably thought it was a new teammate. Like, hey, who's this new guy that we picked up?
Wow, this 14-year-old's got a beard? But just the fact that they actually trust me, and they would come up to me and ask me, you know, what am I doing? You know, how do I fix this? How do I fix that? That made me feel actually really good.
Yeah. No, every one of those kids loved you, and you're always welcome back. I know that you probably have summer plans to go play off in a collegiate league. Which league are you going to play in, by the way? Do you know yet?
Valley.
Nice. Good for you, man.
Good for you, for real. Yeah.
Thanks.
That's good. And you know, so whenever you're done playing, whenever you have time, and I know when you're in college, you ain't going to have much time, but whenever that day comes, you know, like I said, once I find out, if you don't call me first, I'm calling you, you know, because I want you back, you know. So, all right. So that was your best memory, which it was. And hopefully we can throw up a clip on there of Ryan Thomas. It's all over YouTube. It's all over Vine. It's all over Twitter. Like, it's amazing. That clip is amazing. And the emotion, you want to talk about passion and emotion? Watch our team celebrate that. Watch the umpires holding guys back. Like, he's telling everybody to move. Our dugout emptied.
I remember watching that clip a couple of times.
Oh my god! Like, that was
so many people there too. It was ridiculous.
Lizardo was awesome that day. You remember his performance? It was. I mean, that was against
lights out.
From what I
heard, they were good.
No, that's a very good team. We beat the Bandidos, and it was 0-0 game, right? Yeah. Is that the score? Yeah, 0-0 game in the extra innings or in the bottom, whatever it was. And I remember somebody told me Andy Pettit was there watching the game.
His son played.
Okay, yeah. And he goes to one of our parents. He goes, hey, who's this kid? They tell him, they go, oh, he's Luis Lizardo, you know, whatever. He's like, this kid can pitch in the big leagues right now. That's how good he is. He goes, this kid can pitch in the big leagues right now. And he was. Like, Lizardo was unbelievable for, you know, obviously most of the summer. But that day especially, like, I stopped calling pitches for him, like, in the second inning. Like, he was that on. I was like, do whatever you want. And Mike Amditas is catching him. And they've grown up together. So, you know, I said, you guys got this. I'm going to let you guys play because it was a video game, you know, and he's 90 from the left side. He was 90 to 93 that day and spinning it and, you know, throwing chains whenever he wanted to. It was amazing. That was an amazing day and game. And, you know, obviously the end result was pretty damn awesome too. So your funniest memory or story?
Funniest memory. Oh, I got one.
Okay.
I would never, ever forget the look on Kunkel's face when I hit my home run at Terry Park. That was the best.
All right, so you got to give the story, though. You got to give the story.
So the whole summer, you know, we'd go to practice. We'd just go to practice, you know, we raked as a team. Like, we would just go to practice. We would take ground balls for 5 minutes and hit for 2 hours. And Cook would say, hey, guys, whenever you want to just come hit, just let me know. Never mention anything about defense, nothing. Care nothing for it. No defense, nothing. We would just – his motto was doubles and dingers. That's all the man cared about. So we go. I'd hit my BP, you know, ground balls, little flares over the bases. And we got just grown men just hitting balls 30, 40 feet over the fence like it's nothing. And I think it was like my 17U fall, like the tournament before.
You're at Terry Park.
Terry Park. And out, C- Coach Scott Morrison was in the dugout, and he goes, "What are you going to do right here?" And it was like bases loaded, one out. Bases loaded, no outs, and it was like the first inning. We're winning like 6-0 already at the time, and I was like, "Oh, I'm probably going to make the first out, like just messing around." And the first pitch I get, I hit a home run over the left center field fence. I have never hit a ball that far in my life, let alone with wood. And somehow it goes over the fence. And from third base to home plate, I had the biggest smile on my face. Just think, the only thing in my mind was just Kunkel. Right. I hit a couple home runs in my life, so I know it. I don't have to prove it to anybody. But he thought I could never in a million years do that.
And Kunkel used to always make, just so the background story,
always mess with me.
Yeah, Kunkel would always mess with Derek about, because, you know, listen, and he's right. We had gorillas on that team. Like, we had dudes 1 through 9 that could hit the ball 400 feet, you know, and then we have Derek there. So Kunkel, you know, again, he would like to mess with Derek, and he was just constant jabs, you know, like, "Hey, Derek, just saying smart remarks to him about that." So I know, and we texted after, I wasn't there that tournament, but we texted after the tournament, and he told me what he told Kunkel, and it was pretty funny, and I can only imagine his reaction and face. And, you know, deep down inside, obviously he was happy for you, but, you know, he had to eat a lot of his words he had to eat that day. That's for sure. No, that was a good one. All right, so who was, out of all the teammates that you had, okay, with Elite Squad, who would you say is the craziest, the funniest, like, just probably bar none, funniest, craziest teammate you had during your Elite Squad years? Is there anyone that sticks out to you?
Anthony Molina.
Yeah, okay. All right, well, those yes, that would fit the bill. You know, yeah, Tony was an interesting one. he was an interesting one. Never a dull moment with him. But like I tell people, okay, how good of a teammate was he?
Awesome.
One of the best. And I tell people that because there's a lot of people that, you know, have these negative things about Tony. And I keep telling them, I said, "Listen, that kid is one of the best teammates that I've ever had and cared about winning more than a lot of people."
More than anything.
Yep. And he was, you know, again, sometimes he could get a bad rap, whatever. But, yeah, he's definitely crazy. You know, he had his crazy moments. But he was an awesome teammate to everybody. You know, there wasn't a kid on that team that didn't get along with him, that didn't like him. And very few people wanted to win more than he did. So that's good. All right. If you could hit a home run off any former Elite Squad pitcher, who would it be and why?
That's a great question. Yeah.
Anyone. It can be one of your teammates. It can be somebody that you're not teammates with, somebody that you haven't seen in a while. If you could pick one pitcher who you could just hit a jack off, bat flip, and you could go ahead and stare at him. Just because you're former teammates. Garrett. That's your boy. Why Garrett?
I think I'm 0 for lifetime. I'm definitely 0 for lifetime. I don't know how many at-bats, but it's definitely 0 for lifetime off him.
Yeah. Garrett's, you know.
I've faced him maybe 6 or 7 times, and I don't even think I've barreled up a ball against him.
Well, just so you know, Callie, and the people watching, Garrett Rooks pitched for us for 3 years since he was 15 years old. 15 U summer, 16 U summer, 17 U summer. Didn't lose one game.
What?
I don't think he ever gave up a run either.
You're right, man. Like, I don't know. Cali, it is one of the most unbelievable things that I've ever been a part of. 3 years. 3 years didn't lose a ball game for us and had a lot of wins. A lot of wins. And big moments. Like, and it wasn't smoke and mirrors. Like, we're not throwing him against a weaker team in the pool. No, he's throwing one of the first couple games against one of the better teams in the pool, and then he's throwing again in the playoffs or the championship. Like, he was unbelievable. And he still is, man. He's getting some opportunity. And he's at University of Alabama right now as a freshman. I know he's thrown in a few midweek games, and he's doing what Garrett Rooks does. I think by the time his career is over there, he's going to be all right. People are going to really love him because he's a winner, man. But that's interesting you said that. I didn't think you'd say him because I know you guys are good friends, but I didn't realize that he
I feel like he would
you.
Text me after just cracking up. I feel like he would love it if I hit one over. He would
I'm
enjoy
sure.
it.
That, but that's he'd Garrett crack for up. You. That's Garrett for
yeah,
you.
He'd crack up.
Yeah, no, and look, if there's one kid that bleeds Elite Squad, it's Garrett, too. He loved playing with you guys, you know? So if there's somebody that's got to take him yard, I think it's okay if it's an Elite Squad player, you know?
Derek, you say that now, man. You guys are going to match up in a regional in May.
I know. Can you imagine if we're talking about this now in, what, March, and then it actually happens in May? And we're
that
like,
would be so awesome.
Or – or he punches you out and he stares at you the whole way. That's what you get. That's what you get for saying you want to hit him, bro.
And the whole FIU dugout's like, what the heck's going on?
Yeah, wait, why is that guy staring at Derek? And no, Derek's guys, like, dude, let him go. Let him go. Yeah, let him go, guys. He's fine. He's fine.
He's the only guy I could never who you are. If I, you know, I'm playing against you, you're my enemy, whatever. I you're not my friend at the moment. And I'll never forget every time I'd step in the box against him, like my first step out of the game, he would just – he always has his glove, like, over his face, right?
Right, right.
He would lower his glove and just smile at me. I'll never forget my senior year. We're playing at their place, and he did it, and I had to call time because I started laughing.
It's hard. That's it's, true, man. Like, it's so hard to like, not laugh.
He just smiles at me.
That's scary for you, man. That's awesome. Scary for you. And that's, you know, the relationship that those guys had. I mean, you know, that team, you know, Derek's team actually stayed together, you know, their 16U year and 17U year. I mean, a lot of them did play on our 15U team, but we really made a lot of changes come 16U. We had a bunch of new players come in, and they got really close really quick. So that team was basically you guys, the core, you guys were together for 2 years, and you guys got really close. And, you know, I remember how special, you know, how special that the perfect game, the BCS win was, you know, like that tournament was awesome. That's, you know, that's the national championship. And we go out there and we win it. Nick McDonald was, you know, really a nobody at the time, you know, and he was, nobody knew about him. And he goes in their championship game and he's just filth. Like, I think he carried a no hitter until like the fifth inning, you know, the championship game. And he was awesome, you know, but that group, man, that group, like I've talked about Willie and Zach's group, you know, Derek's group's not far behind, man. It's not far behind when it comes to them. And you know, talent, look, on paper, I mean, they stack up. And they will stack up when you see the, their group get drafted and their draft comes up in 3 years. You know, you'll see them. But, like, I'm telling you what, on paper, they're really damn good. And we just had bad luck with that group. You know, like, crazy things happen. We had the World Series basically won in our bag. In the last inning, we're up. And guys that never make an error made a huge error. You know what I mean? And, you know, after the game, you know, they're all dejected. And I told them, I said, guys, I mean, listen, the guy who made the error, I told him, I said, dude, if we gave out awards, you would have won a gold glove for us. That's how good you are, you know? And obviously he got drafted pretty early and he's now playing pro ball. But it was just weird things. Like, we had bad luck happen to us. Weird Jupiter calls when we were in Jupiter. Did you see my tweet today, by the way?
I did. I quoted it.
Did you? I didn't see it. Yeah, but you know, we had a horrible umpire that cost us a game to go to the Final Four in Jupiter. Like, it was just weird stuff
about this, Richie.
Yeah. It was awful. You know, I don't get thrown out of games, and both Kunkel and I got ejected within a minute of each other. You know, and I didn't even really say anything. I just, you know, I guess I was looking in the wrong direction. You know, that's why he threw me out. But anyways, that group that Derek had and was awesome. And, you know, it was such a fun group to be around. Derek was a big reason for that. Before I let you go, Derek, if it wasn't for baseball, or when you're done with baseball, where do you see yourself? What do you want to do? You know, if you weren't playing in college, what would you be doing? So I know it's kind of a tricky question, but tell me first, if you never played baseball, what you think you would be doing. And then tell me secondly, now that you are playing baseball, obviously, what do you want to do when you officially hang up your cleats? So first part is, what do you think you'd be doing if you weren't playing baseball?
Oof. I don't know. I'd probably just be a normal student.
What would you study?
You know, personally. Oof. Probably a lawyer. I like to argue.
You like to argue with me a lot. When I was coaching,
I probably want to be a lawyer.
That's perfect. Perfect. All right. So now that you are a baseball player, what are you going to be doing when it's your time to hang them up, when you're done playing? What do you see yourself doing?
I honestly, you know, my parents ask me this all the time, but I can never see myself sitting at a desk on a computer, on the phone. You know, I see myself doing something that has to do with baseball. I have to be on or around a baseball field.
Right. No, absolutely. And I think that not only do I want you to coach with us, but I think that, you know, honestly speaking, and I know this doesn't bode well for Elite Squad, but you could do so much more, you know, than just coaching for us just because of your personality. And don't get me wrong, I want you. So like, if you're cool with just coaching an elite squad, fine. But in all seriousness, like, you know, with your personality, your work ethic, you know, the type of person you are, you got a bright future in the game of baseball, whether it's coaching at a higher level, whether it's working in a front office, whether it's, you know, I really believe that in you, and what you've been able to accomplish so far has been pretty awesome. And I think that the sky's the limit for you and whatever you decide to do. You know, there's certain people that are just winners, you know, and that's you, you know, whether it's on the baseball field or off the field, you know, that's the type of kid you are. So like I said, selfishly, I would love for you to be elite squad, but I think there's a lot, you know, bigger things ahead for you. And, you know, I can't wait to watch it unfold. And, you know, I can't wait to still yell stuff from the stands at you, you know, cause I miss yelling at you from the dugout. So at FIU, Mike, he was at FIU. He tried to score from first, right? Was it from first or second when I was at the game? Can you hear him, Mike?
No, I can't hear him.
Yeah, Derek, did you hit mute? All right, so what I was saying is,
when you were at FIU.
Yeah, I was at FIU last Sunday. I went to go watch Nick McDonald was starting, one of our guys, and I went to go watch Derek and a couple of our other guys that played for us. But Derek tried to score from second or first?
From first.
Yeah, I knew that was trouble as soon as I saw it. So Merv is waving him around. Coach Melendez is waving him around. He gets thrown out of the plate. Of course, Derek comes up smiling. You know, like he gets thrown out, bang, bang. He comes up just smiling at Merv. And Merv wasn't mad. He was just like, hey, you know, he just tried to squeeze in another run. And I'm yelling, I'm like, you're still slow, Derek, damn it. Like, every time I got him thrown out on the bases, you know, it was never my fault. So I would tell him, dude, you're so slow, Derek. I was like, I thought you were fast. You know, so I used to always blame it on Derek, and he would just laugh at me. And it was kind of like a joke. I was like, dude, you're supposed to be fast, man. But he is pretty quick. But I used to just, you know, always, it couldn't have been my fault, you know, had to be him. So, Cal, you have anything for Derek?
No, man, I think it's great we got you on for kind of talking about passion. I think, you know, you're the type of guy that, you know, with FIU, the up-and-coming program now, you're the perfect guy there. You know, people need guys of character and winners just like you. And I'm really excited to see, you know, not only your future, but, you know, the future of FIU baseball. And, you know, looking forward to the rest of your season and hopefully a regional matchup against Alabama. And,
Dude, listen, we got to go. If that means that we got to fly to Alabama, just we get that matchup.
We get video of the whole thing.
Yeah. That'd be awesome, man. Well, Derek, listen, thank you so much for coming on with us.
Thank you, guys.
I'm so glad you did it. And you know, I hopefully the people watching and all of our up-and-coming players, you know, now realize how important you were to us and how much you've done for us. And it doesn't go unnoticed, man, to play the way that you do and be the type of person you are. So thanks again for everything. Good luck this year. I'll be at a bunch of your games yelling at you still. So I know you like it because every time I yelled at him, he just laughed. So I know it doesn't bother him. All right, D, take care, man. Thanks again.
All right. Thank you.
All right. See you, bud.